Most of you, I know that you are familiar with the plasmapheresis, but also we have different young doctors from different locations, and not all of them are expert in all of the nephrology techniques. So we have to cover this. Also, I need to acknowledge that we have also for the first time in our training, we have medical students from three different medical programs, one from Manchester, from Mansoura University, and one from Faqih Jeddah. So that's why we sometimes speak so basic. So all our young residents and clinical years of medical students can understand what we are talking about besides the advanced ones. From history, plasmapheresis is very old. It go down to the pharaonic era, and it was first documented in Edwin Papirius. But the term plasmapheresis derived partly from the Greek word apheresis, which means taking away or removal. It is unclear exact time of the this therapeutic initiation, but it was flourishing even before Hippocrates in the 5th century BC. Bloodletting to remove evil as was a common place medical practice, partially because of the lack of understanding of the disease process and the paucity of effective therapy. And until now, as you know, we have hijama. Hijama in the Arab world and the Middle East is still one of the therapies, and they have their own society, and they are under regulation now, and it is still done in many countries. This is evolution through the time of the plasma therapy. Since 1902, washing and the return of blood from uremic patient, and then we have a lagging of time to 44 frequent plasma separation. It was possible, and the plasma required during the war. That's why technology evolved. In 52, manual plasmapheresis first used in a therapeutic manner, and in say after 10 years or more than 10 years, in 65, first continuous flow separator been developed and to remove the buffy coat. Then in 70s, start to use plasma exchange for Goodbusher syndrome. And in the 80s, plasmapheresis programs for routine collection of blood products. In 90s, treatment of plasma component, and in 2000, improvement in whole blood technology to replace some plasma treatment. As you can see, we are waving between the clinic and the lab. Sometimes it is go to the clinic immediately to treat some emergent or urgent cases, and then it is developed again in the lab to for better separation of blood products. So as we are talking about separation of blood products, we can also apply apheresis to separate different blood components in certain diseases like in thrombo. In erythrocytosis, we can remove the RBCs, and in sickle cell disease also, we can remove the RBCs. In malaria, we can remove and replace the RBCs with new healthy ones. In leukemias, we can use it during, we are using cell therapies. In thrombocytosis, we can use it to remove platelets above certain limit, and we can use it to remove plasma, which is the focus of our talk today. The removal of plasma, the plasma contain a lot of components that can be abnormal and can be removed by plasmapheresis, including removal of antibodies like in TTB, Guillain-Barré, Myasthenia gravis, Goodbusher syndrome, cryoglobulinemia, immune complex like in lupus, severe lupus, removal of excessive or abnormal substance like paraproteinemia, cholesterol and hypercholesterolemia, removal of toxins, protein-bound drugs, toxins, mushrooms. Actually, I like this slide very much because it summarizes all what I need to say today. You need to know why you are doing plasmapheresis, not just it is written in the book, because you know it is written in the book, and we have ongoing studies. We have published studies comparing plasmapheresis with other approaches. Many studies show that plasmapheresis has no significant role in anything. You can use cyclophosphamide, you can use immune suppression, you can use pulse, and compare it with plasmapheresis in many studies. I am sure many of you can write now a lot of studies that can show plasmapheresis has no significant. Plasmapheresis is a very expensive technique, and it is very difficult to have the replacement fluid, as Dr. Osama was talking about fluid. Now we need a plasma for a replacement. But if you know why you are using plasmapheresis through this slide, it is very beneficial and life-saving technique. And I know many professors even participated or contributed in publishing a lot of research showing plasmapheresis has no significance. At one time, they write by themselves in their prescription plasmapheresis for their patients because it is, at that time, it is indicated. This summarizes what I was talking about. We have a lot of sophisticated techniques for different separation of different components of the blood and for different therapeutic approaches. And we will talk in brief about each one of those ones. So simply, we remove blood from the patient as if we are doing dialysis, but we don't have a dialysate. We are not exchanging blood with any other fluid. It is just a filter with big holes. It is bigger in size, larger in size than the holes, the bores for the hemodialysis. It is called a plasma filter, especially for separation of the plasma proteins. So when the blood entering the filter, it will filtrate the plasma. So you need to replace this plasma, because you may remove 1 liter, 2 liters. If you just remove the plasma, it will end with severe hypotension and your patient will die because it is a very rapid process. So you need to calculate how much actually you need to remove, and I will show you how later on. And you give same amount of the removed plasma replaced with fresh plasma. So we are giving plasma to the patient, and we are removing the other plasma containing either antibodies, toxins, or whatever we want to remove. Of course, we are talking about protein-bound toxins. So here also in this figure, you can show that small molecules are creatinine, BUN, or equivalent toxins can be removed easily by using diffusion. Using the technique of hemodialysis, which depends on diffusion. Just minutes ago, Professor Osama gave you a hint about this one. Going to other larger molecules like vitamin B12, beta-2 microglobulin, and even kappa light chain, this called the middle molecule that it can be removed with another technique. It's called the convection, the hemofiltration. And here the larger molecules like the lambda, light chain, albumin, IgG, IgM can also can be removed by plasmapheresis. This is the guidelines on from the American Society of Apheresis of its use of the therapeutic apheresis in the clinical backgrounds based on clinical studies. We have 4 different categories. Category 1, it is disorders for which apheresis is accepted as first-line therapy, either as a primary standalone therapy treatment or in conjunction with other modes of treatment. Class 2, disorders for which apheresis is accepted as a second-line, so it is not a first-line, either as a standalone treatment or in conjunction with other modes of treatment. So if you notice that plasmapheresis is not a standalone therapy except in category 1. It is always augmenting the therapy. In the stage or category 3, optimum role of apheresis therapy is not established. Well, decision making should be individualized for each patient. While category 4 disorders in which published evidence demonstrates or suggests apheresis to be ineffective or even harmful. So in this condition, IRB approval is desirable if apheresis treatment is undertaken in these circumstances. For whom not familiar with IRB, IRB, it means Institution Review Board. Each hospital, we have IRB board. It is Institution Review Board. It is different specialities, consultant from all the specialties of the hospital, including a lawyer, including an ethical and quality control specialist and experts, all can study the case and give their approval for this condition case by case. So category four, when you see category four for a certain disease, you need to have this multidisciplinary meeting, or if you have IRB in your institution, you ask for IRB approval before you prescribe your plasmapheresis. Otherwise, it will be an ethical issue for you. I will show you a list of different examples of diseases, and I will start with the category one. Category one, like acute inflammatory demyelinating polyradiculoneuropathy, which I mean Guillain-Barré. Guillain-Barré, it is category one. So if you face a case of Guillain-Barré, please prescribe plasmapheresis as a standalone therapy with no fear. You don't need to take opinion of any other institutions. In amyloidosis, it depends. If it is beta 2 microglobulin, it is category 2. So it is after the first line of therapy. While in other causes than dialysis related amyloidosis, it is class 4, you need IRB approval. So it is only the dialysis related amyloidosis that you can, after a failure of the first line or to augment the first line, to do plasmapheresis. Also, in anti-glomerular basement membrane disease, Zygote-Bichar, it is category one. And in the diffuse alveolar hemorrhage, while it is category three in dialysis dependent conditions. It is also category one catastrophic antiphospholipid syndrome, either with lupus or without lupus. Also chronic inflammatory demyelinating disease. If you go one by one like this, you will find your way when and when not to prescribe plasmapheresis. I will take the last one, hereditary hemochromatosis in erythrocytopheresis. So mainly we focus on removing the RBCs, and it is category one. Also, in hyperviscosity and in hypergammaglobulinemia, it is category one. In IgA, it is category three, so you need to increscentic and the chronic progressive diseases. So it augments the primary therapy, and you can also wait for a decision individualized. How we do plasmapheresis? We adjust our machine. We have two types of, the main two types of plasma filters. We have a plasma dialyzer that I will show you later. The hollow fiber can be used on the dialysis machines, and we have the centrifugation. But we adjust the blood flow at a low level, 60 to 100 ml per minute. That equal removal of 20 to 30 ml plasma per minute. It is very important to know the rate of plasma, because you are infusing in the same time a replacement plasma. If you remove in a larger speed, you are not happy. I know we always happy that we will finish early, but we will finish also the patient early. He will not survive, and we will not be happy at the end. And Dr. Osama, as he is the director of syndicate, he will have a talk with us after this. So please don't make a very high speed of your machine. It is very slow technique. And even if you can go less than 60, please do to be less than this level. And if you need to do it fast, you'll be sure that you have a central line, because if you have even a big cannula, you will not have this rate, 20 to 30 minute ml per minute enough through a cannula. You need a central line. So you need a central line before you start plasmapheresis. As you can see, double human femoral or subclavian catheter, or a needle more than 18 gauge in the brachial vein. Anticoagulation, either citrate or heparin. We prefer citrates more than heparin because we are using calcium as a replacement, which will antidote the citrate effect. It is 2 ampoules, 1 gram calcium gluconate, which is equal to 990 elemental calcium. Treatment volume, we have this equation. If we are using one equivalent to plasma volume, we use the following equation: body weight multiplied by 1 over 13 by 1 minus hematocrit over 100. If you use this equation, it will give you the plasma volume. We have two different conditions and the preparation for the plasma. Either we use humanized plasma, so we ask for blood donors. Many donors can come and donate blood, and we can separate plasma from their blood, prepare the volume required, and we give it to the patient. While if we don't have this option, and in certain diseases, we are obligated to not to use fresh frozen plasma, but we need to use a human albumin. So how to prepare the human albumin? We need to know that we have 5% human albumin and 20% human albumin. In case we have 20% human albumin, we prepare our 2 liters of plasma like this, 2 bags of saline and 2 bags of dextrose, 5%. Each bag is 500. We remove fluid 100 from the bag of the fluid, and we bought 120% human albumin, which equal to 2 gram of human albumin. So at the end, we bought 2 gram of human albumin or 100 ml of 20% human albumin, which equal to 100 ml volume and 400 either saline 0.9%, dextrose or dextrose 5%. And we prepare our 2 liters for our syrup. What is the techniques of apheresis? I already told you we can remove different components of the blood. We also have a different approaches to do this. We have a centrifugal device. We have a hollow fiber plasma filter. We have immune adsorption column, and we have plasma component separators. Starting with centrifugation, it is more common in hematology department because, you know, they have the machine in their lab. They are the one who separate the blood components from the donors. And also they can carry on the machine and go to beside the patient and do it. And I will show you an examples from the urology nephrology center. Continuous, it is continuous or intermittent citrate anticoagulation. The other way to do it, and this is preferable for a nephrologist, that we use hollow fiber. But for this centrifugation, it is more common in hematology department, the membrane hollow fiber, more common in nephrology department, and also discontinuous or intermittent and using heparin as anticoagulation. So for the centrifugal devices, it allow, this is the machine, and this is the machine we used in urology nephrology center. We are removing blood from the patient and go to fill a container here in the centrifuge machine, and this container will run in at high speed centrifugation. So the plasma will go out from the centrifugation filter and be collected in this bag. It is very nice machine in donation. We use it for donation. As you know, if you use in the hollow fiber, we need the bags ready for replacement. And also here, we need the bag replacement ready. But if you ask for the plasma pharesis in your blood bank, they will ask you for donors. So each plasma bag, 200 ml, can be separated from one donor. You can imagine you need like 9 bags or 10 bags of plasma. So you will need a bus full of donors coming from the city of this patient. And you know, you will need more than one session. It is from 3 to 5 and sometimes more than this if in case of transplant rejection and in certain diseases with rapidly progressive glomerulonephritis. So how come you will collect all of these donors that can reach to 50 70 donors to treat your patient. This machine, it allow you to separate 9 bags from only 1 donor. You give him only fluid and he can do 1 session without hypotension. The machine is separating only the plasma, so it can separate from 500 to 900 from only 1 donor, and he also can be have good hydration, have monitoring of the serum albumin. He good have a very good diet of high protein diet for 10 days, and he can come back. You check for the serum albumin. If it is normal again, he can donate again. But only 1 session can cost you only 1 donor. So very important machine in donation, more than in the technique itself. But also we did separate plasma by using this machine. All modern centrifugation machines have a therapeutic mode, so it can be used for donation, can be used also for therapeutic plasma pharesis. From my opinion, it was very successful to use it for this patient. So there is no upper limit to molecular weight of protein removal. Blood flow rate, as I told you, can be slow and can reach up to 150, because this machine use a technique that it filled a container, do the centrifugation and returning back the blood, and then taking a new blood again. It is different than dialysis. Dialysis machine, the blood is always in continuous manner. It's taken from the patient, removing fluid, going back to the patient. But here we have a halt of time inside this container. That's why they are using citrate. It is more powerful than heparin, otherwise it will be clotted. And they use calcium to remove the citrate later on. As we told you, you need a central line to do this, or a big needle and umbilical vein. Platelet count should be can be decreased by as much as 50% during the technique. And this through patients from the urology nephrology center, and both adult and pediatric also we can use. And you can see here, this is the plasma prepared from a diluted albumin, human albumin, and this is the patient removed plasma. And of course, this is a patient if you don't recognize him. And this is the adult patient as well. The other way to do it, we all familiar with this. It is a membrane, looks like the dialyzer, but it is written on it, it is plasma, have membrane bores of 0.2 to 0.5. All immunoglobulins will cross the membrane, IgG more efficient than IgM. Large immune complexes and cryo may not be adequately cleared. Many membranes allow clearance of molecules up to 3 million Daltons, and there is no loss of platelet. Otherwise, the centrifugation, there is an issue with the platelets. Here, we don't have any issue with removing the platelets. Hemolysis can occur if transmembrane pressure are too high. Membranes used in plasma filters are polysulfone, polypropylene, cellulose diacetate, polymethyl, metacrylate, or polyacrylonitrile. And we have a session dedicated to Dr. Karim Zat. He will talk in detail about the different membranes. So this is a technique in a simplified manner. We remove blood from the patient. It go into the plasma filter, removing the plasma of the patient. And then while it is going back to the patient, we have a replacement solution at the same rate of removal and at ending with the same volume. So the patient will not have fluid overload or hyperproteinemia or hypoproteinemia or hypovolemia. The third technique is protein A immune adsorption. It is augmenting the plasma pharesis to remove immunoglobulins from the plasma. Protein A selectively bind the FC domain of immunoglobulin molecules. Immune adsorption column can be repeatedly regenerated again. A column can be used for 1 year for a single patient on up to 30 occasions, but of course not in Egypt because we are not allowing recycling. play a key pathogenic role in place of plasma exchange in Goodbusher disease, rheumatoid arthritis, removal anti-ABO or anti-HLA antibodies in highly sensitized transplant recipients. And of course, if you are only targeting removal of immunoglobulins, this will be very important as you will not need replacement of plasma. Mainly, you are removing the protein A immune adsorption through the column and giving back the plasma to the patient. This is immune A, protein A adsorption for IgG, and it is a combination between plasma ferrites to remove the plasma ferrite, and it go to through the protein A column and recollected, removing the IgG, and the remaining cleared plasma go back to the patients. So you saved the patient plasma, removing only the hazard immune globulin. And this is the difference between plasma exchange. We remove all the plasma and we need to replace, while here it is a small volume of waste containing the immunoglobulins and of course a very little amount of plasma needed to replace this amount removed. More efficient. We have also the double filtration plasma ferrites, a membrane filtration to separate cells from plasma, and then secondary plasma filtration to remove plasma solutes based on molecular size. Most albumin is returned to the patient together with lower molecular weight proteins. So here we can also remove certain hazard cells through this double filtration. As you know, in COVID era pandemic, there were a lot of discussions, a lot of interventions, a lot of use of either injecting plasma to block the antibodies, immune complexes regenerated by the COVID-19 virus, or even using plasma ferrites. Many reported success and many did not report the same. So in here, it is the recovery study from Oxford. They are showing that convalescent plasma and also plasma ferrites in patients admitted to hospital with COVID-19 in a randomized controlled open labeled platform trial did not show any improvement in survival or other pre-specific clinical outcomes. Going back to the double filtration, this means that we do the filtration, we remove whatever waste we want, and giving the patient back the amount we need. We have new membranes coming, emerging, Hemophenix technology for nano filtration. As you know, we have two issues, main issues with plasma ferrites. The issue of removing plasma, we need to give the patient plasma and remove only the component of interest like immunoglobulins, RBCs, whatever you want, but not all the plasma all together. And also the vascular access, not all patients like to have a central line and feasible to have a central line. You need to use a small cannula or an ordinary cannula. So they have this new membranes with bore diameter of 20 nanometers, and they have a new machine, Hemophenix nano filtration based. It uses blood plasma filtration at a rate of 100 up to 50 to 100 ml per minute, but it can use an ordinary cannula. So the advantage allow performing the treatment with single and small needle with reduced extracorporeal volume, 70 ml, and you can put the machine bedside beside the patient. Low priming, short duration of treatment, exchange of low volume allows not to use plasma as a replacement fluid, so reduce the risk of infection and allergy as well. Can be comparable or even superior to traditional plasma exit ferrites as it is more tolerable and less invasive. After that, we have as dedicated machines, new technology only for plasma ferrites as these two examples. At the end, early introduction of plasma exchange appears to be effective for various immunologic kidney diseases. However, plasma exchange primarily serves as an adjunctive to other immune suppressive therapies and is often expected to have beneficial role. early diagnosis and the treatment of the underlying condition, and also knowing what you are actually targeting to remove remains the most important issue. And thank you very much.